good to see everybody here today at New Hope Baptist Church. We want to say thank you for coming this morning to our guests. If you have any questions about today's service, any questions about our church, please come see me or any of our ushers after the service today. We'd be happy to answer those things for you. We're certainly glad that you're here today. We have a couple of announcements and prayer requests this morning. The Lord has blessed us here at New Hope Baptist Church. And in this process, we have begun to grow. And as we have begun to grow, we have a lot of families here that have kids and grandkids. And all we can say is praise the Lord for that. And in that process, as we are starting to grow, we are needing to make some changes with some of our Sunday school rooms. And I appreciate the attitude, and I appreciate the hearts of people that don't get so comfortable in their own setting that they're not able to do what the Lord is needing us to do. And Brother Jim Hansen had asked me to announce this. Next week, the Encouragers class with Brother Jerry Coley's class will go to the new fellowship hall in the very back here. And then Brother Steve's class, the Courageous class, will just swap places. They'll go to the old fellowship hall. And as we're seeing these quote-unquote growing pains, in the fifth Sunday of August, we are looking to promote a building fund offering. And we have had people in our church give generously to the building fund. And here's the deal, and I'm just going to shoot straight with you. You can't take it with you. You know that, don't you? And so I want to tell you this. What an honor to the Lord it would be as we get ready to propose to the church here in the next, hopefully, couple of months, a proposal for a Christian Education Center. As we get ready to propose that, what a blessing it would be if the Lord put it on your heart. Money that maybe you've inherited, money that you have just sitting in a nest egg, ready for your kids to fight over, whatever it may be. What if the Lord put it on your heart to give to His kingdom for His glory? If that's the case, you're going to have that opportunity on that fifth Sunday in August. But praise God, we're growing. Praise God, we have a children's church that is busting out the seams. Praise God, we have a nursery that's busting out the seams. Praise God that our Sunday school rooms are getting too small. Those are good problems to have. Praise Him for that today. And so as we think about these things, we have to have a plan of action, and we do have a building utilization committee that has been meeting, and we hope to have you a plan in place for the church to see what your desires would be. And my prayer would be that your desires would be for the will of God, and just be in prayer for that. Today at 4:30, I'd need to meet with all the deacons back in the fellowship hall at 4:30, if you will. A reminder this week, our sponsors, Brother Brennan and our sponsors, are carrying a group to camp in Glorieta, New Mexico. They leave Wednesday morning at 8 o'clock. Anybody that would like to come over here and pray with the kids, be with the kids before they leave, is more than welcome to. I appreciate all of our adult sponsors that are going. But if you've ever been around kids can eat like horses, okay? And if you, I told Miss Joyce Bullard in the 9 a.m. service, she cooked some outstanding cookies. If any of you can cook and would like to make snacks, or just go to Walmart and buy some goldfish or whatever and give to those kids as they go on the trip, it would be greatly appreciated. And you can bring them by at any time. Just let me know, and we'll be sure to get them there for the guys as they get ready to go to camp on June the 16th. Be in prayer for them. June the 17th, which is this Thursday at 6 p.m., Anna would like to invite all ladies to attend the Sisters of New Hope here hosted. Any ladies that would like to come to the ladies' event, please come. Sisters of New Hope here June 17th at 6 p.m. We have our Father's Day service next Sunday, and I hope you guys will be here to celebrate our dads as we come here to celebrate that next Sunday. And then we have another great event coming, especially for me. On July the 3rd at Mineola High School Gym at 6 p.m. Saturday night wrestling is back in Mineola, Texas. We're going to have the Christian Wrestling Federation is going to be here with us, and They put on a promotion in Jacksonville Baptist College, and 7 young people come to know the Lord that evening. So it's a great event, and we are definitely in support of this, and hope that you'll be there and bring your kids. It is very family-friendly and family-organized, so be there for that. Mineola High School, July the 3rd. July the 4th will be that Sunday, and we'll have our patriotic service. Looking forward to that here, our patriotic service at New Hope Baptist Church. Afterwards, we're so grateful for Tisha and Sean Radney. We're going to be helping host a fish fry, and we want all of you to stay. There is no donations, no, hey, we're giving this money to you. It's you come back here and eat fish with us, and let's just have a good time fellowshipping there on July 4th. Come back for the evening service at 6 o'clock. We're going to have a sing-along, patriotic sing-along, along with some patriotic trivia. We're going to have a good time with that. We'd love to have you back on July 4th that evening. May have a little firework or two come out for that and see that on July the 4th. Also, Miss Ashley told you last week we need volunteers for Vacation Bible School. Awesome evangelical outreach as we get ready to celebrate our Bible school this year. It'll be July the 12th through the 16th. If any of you can teach, if any of you can lead singing, if any of you can cook, anything like that, we need you to plug in. You can see Miss Ashley Gilbreth or you can see Miss Jessica Volick and get plugged in. You can see me and we'll get you plugged in for Vacation Bible School. Today we have some things that we'd like to read for you and invite you to. Many of you know General Terry Patton. He is going to be celebrating an 80th birthday, and his party is going to be on June 26, 2021, from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., and it'll be back here at the Church Fellowship Hall, hosted by Miss Susan Patton and their daughter, Teresa. And it's got on here, no gifts, please, but as much as Brother Terry pranks you guys, you need to bring some pranks for him. So be there on June 26th for Brother Terry's birthday. It's going to be a great celebration. We are blessed by the Lord, and we're so thankful today. Let's give the Lord a praise for Miss Kathy Lewis being able to be here in the service today with Brother R.C. And Miss Kathy would like to thank you, New Hope Baptist Church, for all the prayers, love, and concern for me while I was in the hospital and my recovering at home. Thank you for the visits, the food, the cards, the phone calls, and flowers. I appreciate it and love you all, Miss Kathy Lewis. And Miss Kathy, we sure love you too, and so glad that y'all are here today with us. Remember our prayer requests this morning. I'd ask you to continue to pray along with Miss Kathy, Miss Sandy Wright, Miss Barbara Little. Let's lift her up to the Lord. And Miss Becky Osborne had a procedure this week. She is doing better, but let's continue to pray for her. Along with families in sorrow at this time, the Sparkman family, let's remember Miss Patty and her husband Bobby and the passing of Bobby's mother, Miss Dorothy. Let's remember the Sparkman family at this time. And Brother Randy Osborne told me just a while ago that his aunt, his dad's sister in Arkansas, Miss Christine Gray, went to be with the Lord last night, so let's remember this family. I'd ask you to continue to pray for Brother Doug's mother, Miss Gaynell Egerton, in your prayers as well. Continue to lift her up, along with Michael Gilbreth. Brother Michael had a welding accident and had a particle get in his eye, and it has, he has lost his eyesight, but he is going to go to surgery. And let's just pray for the Lord's will on Brother Michael. And also Miss Margaret Cooper had been in the hospital, and continue to pray for her. All are homebound in our nursing home. If you don't have the opportunity to go to the nursing home or Autumn Winds Assisted Living, I would encourage you to do that sometime. It'll lift your spirits, but it'll also make you realize just how good God is. And I think sometimes we need to see that. I'd ask you to remember my dad's cousin, Jody Thorpe, was diagnosed with lung cancer. Along with Miss Mabe, has not been feeling good, and so many of our unspoken requests in our church, we have so many of them that we just ask you to lift these up and be in prayer for them. Brother David and Deanne's daughter Bailey, if I'm not mistaken, will be giving birth on Monday, and so let's pray for her, Bailey Hawkins. Let's lift up Bailey in our prayers as she is welcoming her baby into the world. Is there any other prayer requests this morning? Yes, let's please remember Brother Jerry Coley, as he had a procedure done this past week and not feeling good. So let's thank you, Miss Hanson. Who else? If not anyone else, let's stand, and we'll ask that our ushers come forward as we get ready to worship the Lord in tithes and offerings. Word says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And now try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such a blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. Brother R.C. Lewis, will you take us to the Lord in prayer for our offertory prayer?
What a beautiful day, Lord's Day. Thank you all for being here. So good to see everyone here and worship together and sing Holy, Holy, Holy is our Lord God Almighty. Let's all stand and sing that together.
Shall praise thy name in earth and sky and sea. Holy, blessed Trinity.
Amen. You may be seated. Our focusing on God as our creator this morning, all creatures of our God and King, number 11.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing, Alleluia, Alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with after gleam, oh praise him, oh praise him, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Thou rushing wind, thou art so strong, ye clouds that sail in heaven along, oh praise him, Alleluia. Thou rising morn, oh praise and joys, ye lights of evening find a voice, oh praise him, oh praise him, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Let all the things their creator bless, and worship him in humbleness, oh praise him, Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, oh praise him, oh praise him, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Our next singing song, one of our favorites, is just hard to imagine. One of the favorite things, let me tell you real quick, one of the favorite things I like to do is sleep under the stars. Sometimes when the weather's just right, I'll blow up an air mattress and just sleep on the patio and look up and just look at God's creation. It is amazing just to see God's creation at night, wake up in the morning and see the greenery and everything around. Who can deny him as God Almighty? How great thou art.
My God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration air proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. Last congregational song before we go into our choir special of He Will Come and Save You. How great is our God? Who is this that can calm the sea?
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, but trembles at his voice, that trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise, my heart will sing how great our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
Amen.
Come and say,
Amen. Aren't you thankful for his saving grace this morning? Appreciate the choir and Brother John, Miss Jean, Miss Alicia. Today, as you think about storms, many of you will not forget where you were at on April the 29th, 2017, if you live in the East Texas area. It was one of the greatest storms that ever came through this portion of East Texas. A total of confirmed 9 tornadoes touched down that day. I remember that as youth pastor, I took a group over to Brother Nick Carey's church at Sand Springs Baptist Church for a concert that night. And as I got out there, lost all service to cell phones, and I was on the phone with Jacqueline and lost her and the kids were in the pantry, hunkered down. The storm, the edge of the storm had come across the western part of the county here, and the pews at Sand Springs are like ours, bolted into the ground, and there was a point where we thought we were going to have to get everybody under the pews. But if you remember, over in the Canton area, there was an F4 tornado that developed there, that went through there, that caused a wreckage of 42 miles long. Can you even fathom that? There was also an F2 tornado that day that caused destruction 12 miles long. But the one in the Canton area that caused the 42-mile destruction hit close to a community that Jacqueline and I know well, the Old Bethel community, the Old Bethel Missionary Baptist Church over in the southwest Canton area. Our former youth pastor and music director, Adam Key, is the pastor there, along with my best friend and his wife and kids go to church. That F4 tornado had winds inside of it of 180 miles per hour. And as that tornado come through that community, it narrowly missed the church. But it did affect members of the Old Bethel Missionary Baptist Church. As a matter of fact, a lady by the name of Cheryl Hughes, who was the principal of Yannis High School for a number of years, actively involved in our women's missionary auxiliary along with our girls' missionary auxiliary, her and her husband had been watching the storms as it had been raining on and off throughout the day. Cheryl and her husband, Kenny, went out on the back porch to watch the storm, and as they watched the lightning, as they watched the massive tornado approach, Cheryl went back inside. And, you know, like many of us, you don't think that it'll ever affect you. Well, at that time, a couple of minutes later, Kenny ran back inside and told his wife, "We need to hit the floor." And as they hit the floor, the last words that she heard her husband say is, "The tornado's taking the roof off the house." And the grasp of her husband was left as he was thrown a number of yards away from the house, and she was as well, and suffered spinal injuries, back injuries, lacerations. And Kenny went home to be with the Lord. Cheryl said, quote unquote, "You don't think that this could ever be your last day. You must know where you're going when this life is over." She said, "My faith is the only thing that was able for me to be able to get through this horrific tornado." She said, "I know where my husband is, and I know I'll see him again someday." And the news reporter asked her, "How do you prepare for these horrible storms that may occur in our lives, this physical storm that she went through?" And Cheryl said, "To me, the ultimate preparedness is to have security of Jesus in your life." And that is the truth. The only way that you and I will ever be able to get through the storms of life, physical, mental, spiritual, whatever they may be, is to make sure that Jesus is the one that holds it all together. And so as we think about this today, we are in this portion of Scripture of Mark where Jesus, in full humanity, yet fully God, knows that the storm is going to come. But yet he is on a mission, and he has a purpose of what he is about to do and what he is about to put his disciples into, that he asked them to get into the boat and let's go for a ride. The disciples that day had been through a lot. Jesus had taught and taught and taught that day. He was fatigued, as we're going to see later on in the passages of Scripture. As he taught and taught and taught, I can just imagine on this series of teachings of the parables what these disciples were going through. I can imagine that these disciples were in deep thought of what the teacher had been teaching. I can imagine that these disciples were in deep prayer to God about what he had been showing them. I can imagine that they had a lot of things going on in their mind and in their mind as Jesus is about to tell them, "Let's go to the other side of the sea." Look at verse 35. On the same day that he had done all this teaching, all this preaching, when evening had come, he said to them, talking to the disciples, "Let us cross over to the other side." Let us cross over to the other side. They're on the Sea of Galilee. The Sea of Galilee, we already know from the geography, we've studied this already, but let's rehash a little bit. It's 13 miles long and it's 8 miles wide. And it sits in the midst of mountains all around it. The fresh snow that comes from the Mount Hermon flows down the valley into this fresh-watered body. And in this fresh-watered body, it's Lake Kinneret today. And in that lake, number one, it's the best fishing lake in Israel. And number two, it is also supplies 50% of the fresh water to the nation of Israel. So it's a very important still to the people today over in that part of the world. And here Jesus is getting into this boat with his disciples, and they're about to go across this lake, if you will, this Sea of Galilee, 13 miles long, 8 miles wide, and they're going to go across it, but he's going there for one purpose. And we have to remember that. Jesus, fully God, knows all things. Jesus, fully God, has one purpose, and that is to seek and to save that which is lost. And in that purpose to seek and to save that which is lost, he is going to the other side to find two demon-possessed men running around in a graveyard, cutting themselves with stones that are running around buck naked, and he's going over there to save their souls. Why? So that he can be glorified. Always remember that, church. Our salvation is not in us. Our salvation is in him. He'll be glorified from it. And that is his purpose. That is why they're getting in the boat to go to the other side. We're going to see that not next week because it's Father's Day, but the week after, come back as we find out what he does with the demon-possessed man, or men in another version of the gospel. He's going into Gentile territory to seek out these demon-possessed men. And as he goes over there in verse 36, Mark says that when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. Took him along in the boat as he was. How was he? Well, we're going to find out in just a minute. He was tired. And this is his full humanity on display. Many scholars say that in the boat was 15 foot long. That's not very big, is it, when you think about that? But Mark is the only gospel that we'll see that it says that they took him along in the boat as he was, and there were other little boats also there with him. So we don't know who was in the boat with Jesus. We don't know who the other little boats were, but we know that they had this little small convoy about to go across this Sea of Galilee to go to the south to Decapolis. And as we see this today, what do we see? Well, Jesus is in this boat with these disciples. These other little boats are also with him. And in the midst of it all, and Jesus in full humanity, also fully God, knows that the storm's coming. Now let's talk about the storm, okay? You here today, I'm with you. We're in the boat together. There's some of us in here today that's going through the storm. And I don't know what that looks like for you, but I can tell you what it looks like for me. There's some of you in here today, you are coming out of the storm. And there's some of you in here today, everything is going great, life is good, but get ready, because you're about to go through the storm. That's a promise from the Word of God. And people say, don't preach that, Michael, because I don't want to hear that. I want everything to be peaches and roses. Well, I'm here to tell you today, when you live for Christ, it's the exact opposite. So when we look at this today and we see this, Jesus is getting in the boat. He's in the boat with his disciples. These other little boats are coming with him, and they're going across the Sea of Galilee. Many of you have seen the painting of Rembrandt of the storm. And there is the 12 disciples in one boat, and it is waves crashing all around, and Jesus is back there sleeping, being aroused by the disciples, as we're about to see. Many of you have seen this famous painting. Look at there in verse 37. Verse 37 says, there was a great windstorm that arose. This windstorm. Many theologians that have studied this through history say that the time is 29 AD. I don't know that, but that's what they say. They say it's 29 AD. They say it's the winter of 29 AD. And they say that in the winter of any time, when the mountain winds begin to funnel through, and as they funnel through, it creates, as some theologian says, a seismic-like atmosphere with the huge winds funneling through, like a tornado, like a whirlwind, like a cyclone. And then what did it create next? It created a tsunami. It created a tsunami with the waves. And this huge windstorm, this great windstorm that arose, it's coming down the mountains, it's coming up onto the Sea of Galilee, and the next part there in verse 37 says, the waves beat into the boat. The actual language is this, the waves were overflowing the boat. They were spilling over the boat. Now listen, Jacqueline and I were on a major cruise line going to Alaska, and we got out on some choppy waters, and our stomachs were going up and down. Y'all ever been there before? On a major cruise line. And I can tell you, we were a little bit shaky. I can't imagine being on a 15-foot boat with a windstorm coming off the mountains like it was, hitting those waves and stirring it up like this great tsunami, and being in that boat going up and down, and the waves crashing over into that small little vessel. Can you just picture that right now? I don't know about you, but I'd be scared to death. Can I get a witness today? Look at verse 38. This furious squall had come up on them. And in verse 38, he was in the stern, asleep on the pillow. In the stern, he's in the back of the boat. The bow, the front, starboard right, port left. He's in the stern, in the back of the boat, and he's sleeping on a pillow. Greek means row cushion. He had laid down to sleep. In the process here, we see the full humanity of Jesus Christ. This is beautiful. This is beautiful. You say, Michael, why is this beautiful? We see the full humanity of Jesus Christ. He was in the stern, asleep on a pillow in the middle of this crazy, wild storm. Because Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews says this, therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. I am thankful for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He knows what we're going through, folks. Hey, there's some of you here today, your nerves are shot. He knows what you're going through. There's some of you here today, you're going through the peaks and valleys of marriage relationship. He knows what you're going through. There's some of you in here today facing job loss and facing fears of not being able to feed your family. He knows what you're going through today. There's some of you here today that have mental depression and you have things that get a hold on you, and sometimes you just want to sing the blues rather than sing praises to God. Listen to me. He knows what you're going through. I'm thankful for our Savior today. Our Savior, He's here in the boat. He's in the back of the boat. He's asleep on a pillow. And this storm is so wild and so crazy and so seismic and so big that you got Andrew and Peter who are brothers. You got James and John who were brothers. And these guys are pro fishermen. They've done this all their life. Don't you think they've been out there on the lake when they've had a few storms? Sure they have. But this scared them to death. Scared them to death. And they're right there following Jesus like you and I are supposed to. And you say, Michael, doesn't that exempt us from the storms of life? Doesn't that make us stay away from all the bad things that are going to happen to us? No, not at all. Dr. David Jeremiah said this, storms come, number one, even when you're near God. Storms come, number two, when you seem like you're doing the right thing. You're coming to church. You're praising God. You're giving to God. You're serving God. Still, storms are going to come. Number three, you say, Lord, I'm not sinning against you. I know I'm sinning, but I'm not doing this blatant, aggravated sin against you. I'm not doing this sin against you, but still, storms come, even when you feel like you're living a righteous life. Dr. Jeremiah said, storms come even when you feel like you're in His perfect will. Storms come. Why do storms come? Well, 2 Timothy 3:12 says, yes, all who desire to live a godly life in Jesus Christ will what? Will suffer persecution. You and I will have storms. Why? Because of who we are. Child of the King. We'll have storms. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 and 13 says this. And I think sometimes we get shocked. God, why are you doing this to me? God, why am I going through this? God, why is this happening to me? And these questions arise in our mind over and over again. And Peter tells us this. He says in verse 12, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. Listen to, he tells us how to handle it. Rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when His glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. Wow. Count it joy in all trials. James 1:2. How in the world can we do that? Well, let me tell you something. You and I in the flesh cannot do that. That's why we need the Lord Jesus Christ today. So when we look at this and we see this, we see Jesus asleep in the stern on a pillow, and here is the disciples. The disciples, this is us. This is the typical Baptist. The language here is they're reproaching him, they're rebuking him. And they go to him and they say, "Teacher, do you not care that we're dying? Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? Teacher, do you not care? Rabbi, Master, whatever, Lord, whatever word you want to use there, do you not care that we're dying?" Wow. The disciples are like us. Some preacher put it this way: we're real good at treating the Lord like a genie in a bottle. When things go bad, what's the first thing we want to do? "Oh Lord, I need your help." But when things are going good, we lay out a church, we lay out a service, we lay out a giving, we lay out a doing everything because things are going so good. I'm here to tell you today, our Lord and Savior deserves praise through the thick, through the thin, and at all times glory be to Him. Do you not care that we're perishing? Do you not care that we're dying? This is who we are, people. This may make you mad, but this is who we are. I have gone through the storm. Can I get a witness? I have come out of the storm. Can I get a witness? And I know this. I'm about to go through another storm. And all of God's people said amen. It's who we are. That's what's going to happen to us. And so when we're young in Christ, what do? The first thing that I always did was this. I'd always say, "God, why are you singling me out?" I'd have kids at school tell me that. Big old group of them would do something, and I'd get on to them, and the kid said, "Why are you singling me out?" Right? And isn't that how we are, this childish attitude towards God? "God, why are you singling me out? Hadn't you seen the way old Jimmy lives down the street here? Hadn't you seen the way old Susie lives down the street here? Why are you singling me out?" And we have this condemnation, if you will, in our hearts. Another thing that we go through is this. We go through judgment. Judgment from God. Did you know most of the storms in our life are brought on by ourselves? Brought on by ourselves. I'm dealing with physical issues right now. Well, why are you dealing with physical issues right now? Because I eat a whole chocolate pie before I go to bed, right? And we ask ourselves, "I got high cholesterol, I got high blood pressure, I got this, I got that." And we ask ourselves, "I've got all these physical ailments in my life." And we look at ourselves and say, "God, why are you doing this to me?" When we really need to be looking in the mirror. I'm preaching to me right now, okay? And you think about all the storms that come in our lives and all the things that come down on us in our lives, and we wonder why we're going through these things in our lives, and a lot of it's brought on by ourselves. And God judges us for that. Because He is righteous, He is holy, He is just. What is He trying to teach us? Well, number one, I really believe that the Lord disciplines those He loves. That's scriptural. And a lot of people don't like to hear that, but I truly believe that if you're going through the storm right now and He's taking you to the woodshed with His belt, that is exactly what you and I need. Why? Because it gives Him glory. Discipline. Not only discipline, but what's another reason He does? He does this because He wants to instruct us. He's molding us. Remember, church, He is the potter, we're the clay. And sometimes we reverse those roles, don't we? Sometimes we like to think we're more than God. Let me tell you something, folks. Our thoughts are not His thoughts. And so when you look at this today and you see this today, you see this instruction. Some of you have gone through things today and you say, "God, why have I been through these things in my life?" And then you've had people in the church, you've had people at your work, you've had people in your family that you've been able to help them and been able to comfort them because you have gone through those things. You've been able to tell them from your testimony, from your experience. That's why kids, young people, listen. It is good to listen to your elders because they have been there and done that and they can give you godly wisdom, I hope, to help you not make mistakes that they've made in life. Sometimes we suffer for the will of God because He wants to provide patience for us. And there's a lot of us in here today that need patience. Amen. And then there's sometimes he does what? We suffer for the will of God because why? He wants to prove to us that he is God. And he does that over and over again. I think about all the ridiculous times that I have worried. I think about all the ridiculous times that I have fretted. I think about all the ridiculous times that I have been nervous about life in general. And I think about that and think about, God, why do I do this? Why do I have so little faith? Because all the times in the past, as I was getting ready to go through the storm, as I was going through the storm, amen, I'm fixing to start shouting today, he has brought me out of the storm. And as he has brought me out of the storm, he did not put me on sand that made me sink. He placed me on solid ground. And he's done the same for you. And if you reflect back in your life of all the good things that God has done for you, all you can do is praise him today. Praise him today. I hate when people say, oh, I got lucky. I got lucky. I had a wreck over here. I told y'all before. I flew off the loop over here on the New Hope Loop of all things and wound up in Ben Steen's pasture, flipped my vehicle. And somebody said, well, you got lucky. No, I didn't get lucky. It was by the grace of God I'm standing here today. I hear people say, oh, I'm taking my chances, you know. Or you know what? I had good doctors and nurses. You know, I was brought through this disease or I was brought through this ailment and I was done this because, man, I was just surrounded by great nurses and great doctors. Praise God for them, but the reason you're here today is because of his grace and his grace alone. Always remember that. And so when we think about that and reflect back upon that, those disciples, man, they were scared. Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing? Verse 39, he wakes up. He arose, and the first thing that he done is he rebuked the wind. Rebuke means that he silenced it. He ordered it, much like he did the same language is used when he silences or calls out a demon from a demon-possessed man. He calls it out. And many people back in the antiquated times believed that storms were created by demonic forces. And Jesus, who is the creator, who is the creator of the winds and the seas, what does he do? What does he do? He silences this wind. He orders the wind, and the wind stops, and he said to the sea, I love this, peace be still. Peace be still. The one who created the sea and wind controls them in the midst of the storm. That's mind-boggling to me. Psalm 89:9 says, you rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them. Psalms 93:4 says, the Lord on high is mightier than the noise of many waters, than the mighty waves of the sea. Psalms 107:29 says, he calms the storm. So why? The waves are still. They're still. So what did he do here? He said, peace, shalom, be still. The Greek is actually, it muzzled. It put a muzzle on a wild animal that could bite. He muzzled the winds and the waves. Wow. Muzzled them. Isn't that amazing? Shut them down so that they had no power anymore. Now watch this. The Bible says in Mark chapter 4, verse 39, the wind ceased and there was a great calm. This wind that was probably more magnificent than a 180-mile-per-hour F4 tornado, the wind stopped, and the Bible says there was a great calm on the sea. What does this mean? That the sea was still. Now, many of you have been out on the ocean, and many of you have been out on the lake, and you know when the storm comes through, and the storm may pass, and the sun may come out, those waves are still going to be as choppy as all get out. I believe on that day on the Sea of Galilee when Jesus rebuked the wind and silenced the storm and said, peace be still, I believe that it was as placid as a pond in your backyard. I believe it was placid. There wasn't no waves hitting the shore. There wasn't no wind blowing. When he said, "Peace be still." In that verse before, we saw full humanity. In this verse now, we see Almighty God. Wow. Wow. The wind was literally muzzled. The sea and wind stopped. And as there was a great calm, look at what he did next. He handled the thing that was right before him, the emergency that was right before him. It was no emergency to him, but it was an emergency to the disciples. And then look what he said to the disciples. In church, I think he's telling us this same thing today. Why are you so fearful? The Greek word means this. Why are you such a coward? Why are you such a coward? Why are you so scared? Why are you so fearful? Why are you such a coward? Don't you know that I am in control? And boy, don't we lose focus on that. Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Man, don't you know these men? After the wind had ceased, after the waves had calmed, and they're sitting out there in the boat, and Jesus tells them this, I can just imagine James and John, the sons of thunder. I can just imagine Andrew and Peter. I can just imagine those disciples sitting there looking at Jesus, and Jesus tells them this, why are you being such a coward? Why is it that you have no faith? Can't you just imagine that their heads sunk? And they wouldn't look him in the eye. I don't know that. But I can imagine that their big boisterous attitude of, let me show you how to steer this boat. Let me show you how to get you out of this storm. Let me show you, Jesus, we need you to help us get out of this situation. Don't you know their heads sank and they probably couldn't even look him in the eye. Why? Because what they realize? He's the Son of God. And so many times, we say, Jesus is my friend. Jesus, I seen this stupid shirt in New York City one time. Jacqueline and I went up there on vacation, and this girl was walking down the street with a shirt that said, Jesus is my homeboy. What ridiculous notions that people have of Jesus. These disciples hung their head. And listen to what they said in their little sidebar conversations. They feared exceedingly. It means to fear a great fear. It means that they were in awe of who He is. Now, church, let's take a time out for a second. Do we really come into His house with an awe of who He is? Do we really pray today that, Lord, you are going to meet with us and there's going to be great things happening? Or we just go through the routine of the old same old monotonous motion of going to church? When I think about this today, we need to be in all reverential respect to who we come here to worship. When we sing, when we give, when we read the Word, whatever we do it for the glory of God. They had their little sidebar conversation. They said, who can this be? Who in the world is this? That even the wind and sea obey Him. Wow. Dr. John MacArthur said this. What was more terrifying to the disciples? The storm on the outside of the boat, or being face to face with God in the flesh on the inside of the boat? I think that's a question we need to ask ourselves today. So many times, when we're about to go in the storm, when we're going through the storm, when we come out of the storm, we use God like He's a genie in a bottle. We only come to Him when we're in need. We only come to Him when we need help. And let me tell you something today. Our Lord and Savior deserves praise through the thick, through the thin. Whatever may be going on in your life, and you feel like you can't praise, know this.
When you're commanded to praise, give him praise. And you will be blessed for it. And when I think about this today, I think about what he told John in Revelation. He says, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. How many of you believe that today? How many of you believe that he is the Alpha and the Omega? He told the disciples over in John. And I want to read this before we get to the next portion of our worship service. In John chapter 16, verse 33, to my friends out there that are struggling, to my friends out there, you're going through tough times. To my friends out there that have marriages that are on the rocks, to my friends out there that have situations with your kids, to my friends out there that have lost your jobs, to my friends out there that life has a hold on you and you feel like it's not going to let you go. The answer today is not some program. The answer today is not medications prescribed by your doctor. The answer today is these things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But listen to what he says. Be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Aren't you thankful for Jesus Christ today? Hey, listen. We hadn't done this in a while. And we're not doing it as an invitation so much as a time for you to pray. I think a lot of the time in church, we're so rigid. And I know we're to be constructing an order of worship because our God loves an ordered worship service. But you know, we need a time to pray. In this time right now, I'm going to give you the opportunity to just pray. Give you the opportunity to just pray where you're at. There may be some of you feel led to come kneel at the altar and pray. That's whatever the Lord puts on your heart. But now, it's the time to do it. You know, one thing I've known about life, and let me ask you if you're in the same boat, quote unquote, I am. It gets so busy sometimes that we forget to stop and be still and know that He is God. So right now, I want you just to stop. I don't know what's going on in your hearts, in your personal life, what you're struggling with. But I'm thankful today that the answer is Jesus, and He knows exactly what's going on. And He's ready to help you. He says, cast all your cares upon Him because He cares for you. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. And whatever's happening in your life today, just give it to Him. And praise God, His will be done. I've asked John to sing a favorite of mine, favorite of probably many of yours, but I think it ties in directly to the message today. As Brother John sings this special, I ask you to pray, and I ask you to pray to the Lord for those storms that may be yet to come, for those storms that you're going through right now. Or what about this? Just a couple of weeks ago, I was unemployed, and I was in the middle of a storm, and God employed me with a job, and I'm coming out of that storm, and what do I need to do? I need to praise Him. I need to praise Him. Praise Him today for who He is. Listen to the words of this song.
I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea. By faith alone, sight unknown, and yet His eyes watching me. The anchor holds. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I've had visions, I've had dreams, I've even held them in my hand. But I never knew they would slip right through like they were only grains of sand. The anchor holds. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have been young, but I'm older now, and there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life. Oh, that's where God poured His love to me. But the anchor holds. Though the ship's been battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging sea. The anchor holds in spite of the storm.
Thank you, Brother John. Hey, listen, we could have testimonial time right now and we'd be here all week long. You've been through the storms, haven't you? But you know the anchor holds, and that anchor's Jesus Christ. Praise Him today for who He is. As we stand and get ready to be dismissed, as we're going to close out with a hymn of praise. My prayer is that you have a great week. And we want to invite you back tonight as we've been studying the book of Proverbs. Tonight we'll be in Proverbs chapter 10, verses 18 through 32. And these are Proverbs of contrast. And if you ever need a pathway of life to live, whew, I tell you what, the book of Proverbs is rich. And I'd invite you back to come to the service tonight. Let's stand. Deacons, don't forget, let's meet at 4:30. And we'll see you back tonight at 6 o'clock. Brother John, what special will we have to close?
I'm just going to finish out with How Great Thou Art.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art.
Man, have a great afternoon. Choir at 4:30. Come and give it a try.